Victory Bible Fellowship. It's a good day.
It's another day in the house of the Lord. We declare that this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice.
Victory Bible Fellowship is a Bible-believing church. Worship is central to our lives and ministry as a church. It is not merely preparation for teaching and preaching. It's an end to itself. Our vision is clear. We win souls, consolidate, and make disciples. This is accomplished through cell groups, street evangelism, our workplaces, businesses, and community engagement. Comprehensive youth and children's ministry makes up a large part of what we do, and their development is vital to our growth and outreach. We continue to support missions to the nations of Africa through partnerships, establishment of churches, and Christian schools. We encourage you to share in worship as we sing, dance, clap, and raise our hands in adoration to the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. Let's stand in the house of the Lord. It's great to be in the house of the Lord another Sunday, united as one body to give him the glory and the praise, because he's indeed worthy. We come this morning with a heart of thanksgiving to worship our Lord and Savior. Let us give thanks to God for all the gifts so freely bestowed upon us, for the beauty and wonder of his creation in earth, sky, and sea, for all that is gracious in our lives, revealing the image of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for our daily food, drink, homes, families, or friends, for the minds that he has given us to think, for the lips that he has given us to give him praise, the hearts that he has given us to love, and the hands that he has given us to serve. We thank you, Lord, for health, for strength to work, mere fact that we can have leisure time to rest and to recuperate and to play and to have fun with each other, for his relentless healing power. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, even today we are thankful for the brave, the courageous, those who are patient in suffering and faithful in adversity. We thank you, O God, for all the valiant seekers of truth, liberty, and justice, for the communion of our church in all times, places, like we are here this morning. Above all, we give thanks to God for his mercies and his promises given to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. And there is so much power in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Psalms 95 reads, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving, extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if only you would hear his voice." So today, we will hear and we will obey his voice this morning. We will come with thanksgiving and worship the King of Kings. Our God, our Father, has blessed us with every spiritual blessing that comes from him. He knew us before the world began. He loves us so much, and we were talking about that this morning, that he calls us his own children. He has brought us out of darkness into light and filled us with his glorious power. He has prepared an inheritance for us that will never spoil or fade. He encourages and strengthens us even when we are not having a good time, when we are weak. He strengthens our body. He comforts us in time of trouble so that we can comfort others. This is our mighty God that's worthy of all praise and of all adoration. He is the ultimate source of everything that we need and the one for whom that we should be living for. So this morning, we're going to praise him with a heart of thanksgiving. We're going to praise him regardless of what the physical body may be saying, the mind may be saying, but we're going to block that all out this morning. And we're going to come with thanksgiving and just worship the Lord, our God, and give him the glory and the praise. Mighty God, we thank you. We thank you for a new day. Lord, for the sun that came out this morning, for the breath that you blew into our bodies this morning, and we are here, and those who are on their way, and those who are watching online, mighty God, just to give you the glory and the praise, because you're truly worthy. We thank you, mighty God, that you are a faithful God. We thank you that you're a loving God. We thank you that you're a God that protects us. You're a God that heals us. You're a God who calls us friend, mighty God. You are a God who holds us in the palm of your hand. You're a God, mighty God, who bend down your ears to hear when we are speaking. And mighty God, wherever we are, you are there with us, hearing us, Lord, bringing us through. And so, mighty God, we are grateful. We are thankful for you this morning. And we just give you the glory and the praise. Mighty God, as we come, we ask you even now just to remove anything negative, anything that is not of you. Thoughts, action, words, remove it in the name of Jesus. And mighty God, we just come surrendering in a grateful thankfulness just to worship you and to honor you. And we just thank you, Lord Jesus, for this opportunity. And we just give you the glory and the praise, because indeed you are our mighty God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's worship.
Let's lift our hands in the name of Jesus. Come on, let's begin to pour out a praise. Let's begin to worship God. He's been so good to us. He's a great Savior. He's an awesome Father. He's a great, great Father. God, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the space here today, once again, God, to praise your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Our Father, all of heaven rules your name. Sing loud. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear the sound of heaven touching earth? Oh. Our Father, all of heaven rules your name. Sing louder. Let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Our Father, all of heaven, sing louder. Let this place erupt. Can you hear it? Help me sing it.
I'm so glad That's not where the story ends.
Yes.
The Lamb that was slain that day, he rose in victory.
Yes.
Since that day, sin has lost its grip on me. Oh, oh, hallelujah. He's alive. Hallelujah. He's alive.
Come on, let's put your hands together. We serve a risen Savior. That's right. And guess what? He gave us a reason to dance. Let's go.
He gave me a reason to dance. Hallelujah. Gave me a reason to dance.
Come on and move your feet.
Gave me a reason to dance. Hallelujah. Gave me a reason to dance.
Yeah. Savior.
He's risen.
And he deserves all the glory and all the praise.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you're worthy. Hallelujah.
It's so good to be in the presence of God. It feels so great to be wrapped up in his arms. Hallelujah, God, I thank you. Thank you for covering me under your wings, Jesus. Hallelujah.
You are God, and you're in control.
Jehovah,
things will change.
Things will change. the King of all kings.
Oh, yes, you
the
are.
Lord of all lords.
Oh, glory.
Our Savior.
Oh,
he
glory.
Rose for us. He died for us. So the least we can do is give him some praise.
Hallelujah.
Our praise is our weapon, people.
Hallelujah.
That's our weapon. So when we come into the house of God, we lift our hands. We lift our voices.
Glory
we move our feet. Because he's deserving
glory.
Of it all.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
You're worthy to be praised, God.
Oh, God. We love you.
Thank you, Jesus.
God, we love you, Jesus.
Come on, let's just close our eyes. Lift our hands to the heavens and just focus. It's just you and him. Nobody else is here. Nobody else matters at this time. It's just you and your Savior. Tell him exactly what you want. He will give it to you. God, we give you praise. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, they shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him do I put all of my trust. God, we cannot do it on our own, Jesus. We are nothing without you, and we are everything with you. God, we believe that and we know that. You are working all things out for our good right now. Even in the bad times, we still gotta praise.
You give light, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out a praise. cry, these bones will say, great.
Stillness in this atmosphere. And I say, God, take your place, God. All around. the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with your love, your love. So
Fresh on us, we need your presence. your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Not my will. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done.
Let your will.
Let your kingdom come, and let your will be done. 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 Miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. He's dwelling with us. The evidence is all around. That the Spirit of the Lord is here. A miracle can happen now.
Yes. Is there anybody here right now experiencing any kind of chest pains or panic attack? Come to the front. A miracle will happen now.
For the Spirit of the Lord.
Let me just repeat it. Anybody experiencing a chest pains, tightness, heart issues, panic attack, serious anxieties, let's come to the front. I experienced some symptoms today. It's unusual. Let's bring it on a little bit. I experienced some symptoms today that I know was not for me and was unusual. And we asked in our pre-service prayer if there was anybody here. So let me say it again. If you're experiencing any chest pains, tightness of a chest, panic attack, anxieties, a miracle will take place now for you. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. That names carry authority. It carries a license to do whatever Jesus did and what the Holy Spirit has given us to do. We're going to demonstrate the power of God in this place because the atmosphere has changed and the Spirit of God is here. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Red ushers.
Praise you, Jesus. Praise you. Hallelujah. The presence of the Lord is in this place. The presence of the Lord is in this place. The presence of the Lord is in this place. I said the presence of the Lord is in this place. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. He is here. He is here. He is here. The presence of the Lord is in this place. He's here. He's here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. He's not done. He's not done. You know, just before Pastor Dennis came up, I heard deliverance, deliverance, deliverance. I heard it, deliverance. And immediately I saw Pastor Dennis come up. The Holy Spirit wants to do a work in us today, all of us. Hallelujah. And you know, I believe, I shared it earlier on, that in order for him to do what he wants to do, he wants us to receive his love. In John 15 and verse 13, it says, greater love than this had no man than for him to lay down his life for his friend. Can you imagine? Greater love than this can no man experience than the one who laid his life down for us. I don't think any of us have a friend who would lay down his or her life for us. I certainly don't think I have that kind of a person. But God, God, who loved us so much, he sent his son to lay his life down for us. And the Lord wants us today to experience that kind of love. It's not the love that is here now and it's not there tomorrow. It's the unchanging, uncompromised, unfathomable. It is the unhindered love of God. It's the love that has no limit. It has no end. It is the love that is pure, the love that is kind, the love that is forgiving, the love that says, I will not forsake you. This morning, I know that we have questions, and the Lord wants us to put those questions aside this morning. Stop the reasoning now and just accept the love that God has for you, the love that he has for me. Just receive it. Allow it to permeate your whole being. Allow it to just fill your heart. Allow it to move from your head into your heart so that you can understand and so that you can comprehend all that he has for you. Oh, precious God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. On Tuesday, the teaching was about fear and how we can avoid it or how we can negate it. And the Holy Spirit revived my heart concerning the love of God for me. And I would love for every one of us this morning to just leave this place knowing I am loved. I am love. Nothing can change God's love for me. Nothing I can do will ever allow him to love me less. He just loves me unconditionally, intentionally. He loves us. So for all of us this morning, I want us to call on the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, help me to receive this love that you have for me, this pure love, this love that does not allow me to feel condemned, the love that cannot do, that will never ever allow me to feel forsaken. I know some of us here this morning by the Spirit of God feel that I'm forsaken. I'm undone. Look what I have done. Look what I did. And this morning, I feel like I'm alone. The love of God pushes that away. Every anxiety, every uncertainty, every failure, every fear, every shame, every feeling of no self-worth, the love of God destroys that this morning. I want us to receive the love of God. The communion table here, it's a symbol of that love that God has for us. It is the expression of the eternal love that he will continue to have for us. It is God's best given to us. In John 3:16 it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. And he goes on to say, God did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He has no condemnation in store for us. So whatever it is that the enemy is trying to use to condemn you this morning, the love of God totally, totally erased that thing. So this morning, I call on us to receive the love of God. It's free. It is for you. It is for me. God wants us to receive it. And if there is someone who has never received Jesus as Lord and Savior, you can right now, right where you are, you can say, Jesus, I believe you died for my sins. I believe you have given me eternal life. I receive your unconditional love. I believe you are my Lord. We can say that right now. And I can tell you, he hears that prayer and you are saved just by acknowledging God as your Lord. He said that, you know, those who believe on his name will not be condemned. But if you refuse to believe on his name, then you are condemned already because you refuse to believe in the only begotten Son of God. This morning, God loves you. Hallelujah. Service.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, my God, that your love knows no limit. It knows no end. Lord God, it reaches to the highest star and goes to the lowest plane. Lord God, we thank you that whatever condition we are in today, your love is able to penetrate. Your love is able to save to the utmost. Father God, we receive your love today. We receive your love. Thank you, Lord God, that you came and you laid your life down for your friends. Lord, we are your friends. And today we pray, oh God, that we will reciprocate your love to us. Lord God, we will do, Lord God, something, my God, to show you that we love you, Lord God. Father God, thank you, because all that we can do is from you. So Father God, we bless you. We bless the bread and we bless the wine, and we say, Lord God, this is your body that was broken. You have taken everything, Lord God, that was against us in the flesh, and you have given us your righteousness. Thank you, Lord God, for your blood that was shed. Lord God, we are under a new covenant. We are a new people. We are a new creation. Nothing, my God, can stand against your blood. So we bless the bread and the wine, and we give you all the praises in Jesus' name. Let's eat together. Let's drink together.
Our worship continues. We're going to worship the Lord in our giving. And so we have had the covenant meal. And so we know that when God makes a covenant, he doesn't break it. And so we are in covenant with the Lord. So whatever he says to us, he's not going to change his mind. So the scripture tells us in 2 Peter 1 and verse 3, it says, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. So everything means everything. It doesn't exclude some big dollar items. It means everything. So everything financially that we need, he's not going to provide. He has already provided. And so we have to receive it by faith, because what we see is not all that he has for us. If we could see with our spiritual eyes how God is turning things, shifting things, moving, just reshuffling, just to make sure that in the end it is good for us, we would be running up here to give our best to the Lord, because he only has good things for us. And so we have to say what the word says about us. And so this morning, I'm going to ask us to just, let's all, we haven't had that declaration, but it's not that we don't remember what we have in the Lord. So this morning, I'm going to ask us to say after me as we make our faith declaration regarding our tithes and offerings. So please say after me, Lord. Lord, you have been good to us. It is my greatest joy to present my tithe and offering to you. I am a tither. This means that I bring in all the tithe, the full 10%, in your storehouse 52 weeks every year. Because I'm a tither, Satan has zero access to my finances. I'm also God's giving machine, God's distribution center. Therefore, I have an abundance, an overflow, and a surplus for every good work. The heathen around see that I am called by the name of the Lord, because the blessing of the Lord makes me rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. Lord, I thank you for all the unmerited favor, wealth and prosperity that you have given to me. Thank you for taking care of all my debts. And in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I am debt free. Amen. So you have made your declarations. Rejoice exceedingly before God. Clap your hands. Clap your hands and shout with a voice of triumph, and come and give to the Lord. Amen.
Victory Bible Fellowship thanks you for partnering with us in the building of God's kingdom. Victory Bible Fellowship believes that a part of worshiping God is expressed in our giving. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9, verses 6 to 8, remember this, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each decide in your hearts how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. We thank God for you, and we believe the seeds that you sow will produce a harvest of generosity in you. The information to give is on the screen. Thanks for being a blessing.
Let's stand while we bless our tithe and offering, please. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. While Pastor Pat was, leading the communion session, the expression of God's love, when it pierces your heart, when you think of who you are, how broken you are, what you are, and you think of how God is so consistent, it makes you want to melt when you really think about the love of God. His love is true. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you, mighty God, for your greatness. We thank you, God, for who you are. You are the amazing God. And we are so grateful to be in your presence today. We thank you, mighty God, for the opportunity, mighty God, to sow into your kingdom, mighty God. We thank you, God, for every hand that stretched forth to give today. We declare an abundance on them in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, mighty God, that, Lord Jesus, you are the God that does the multiplication. And so, God, we envision the multiplication in this place over your people, my God. We thank you, God, that we have the ability and we are in obedience. And, oh God, we know, God, that you are not a God that your word lie. You are a God that stands strong to your word. And you promise us a reward. So we give you thanks, God, for everything that you do. We thank you that Victory Bible Fellowship is a giving church. And Father, as we give back to the community, we give you thanks, God, that you continue to bless us. We pray this and much more in your name. Amen.
Almighty God, we give you thanks today for our nation's veterans. We honor them for their faithful service in defending and preserving our freedom. We are grateful to those who served during times of peace. Standing ready, bravely awaiting their call to duty. We are grateful to those who served during times of unrest. Enduring conflict and bearing the physical and spiritual wounds of war. We ask that you bless them. Heal their wounds, and give them peace. We thank you, God, for all our veterans, those of generations past and present. May we never forget what our country has asked of them and what they have given in return. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to start today by thanking all those among us who, despite the risk and sacrifice, raised their hand to serve and defend this beautiful country. Our veterans, active duty, service members, guardsmen, and reservists, your service has helped keep our country and its citizens safe and free. If there are any veterans or active duty in the building right now, can you please stand up to be recognized? Let's also take a moment to acknowledge the families of service members and veterans, the mothers, fathers, spouses, and children of our military men and women. Thank you. I know watching that family member that took the oath and put their uniform on can be scary, but your love, support, and resilience is the backbone of this nation, and that must never be forgotten. A veteran is someone who was or is currently in the military. They live a disciplined life so that we don't have to. They go off to war to ensure our freedom and protect our way of life. We must not forget them. We must honor and appreciate these courageous people who go out there and fight for us. To us, they are heroes, but to them, they are just normal people doing their job, waking up every day to protect this country. Any service member will tell you that the real heroes are those who have gone out there and died on the battlefield fighting along their brothers and sisters. So we honor them for every time the sun rises and the sun sets, we hear colors play, and we salute to those who have died for this country. Your inspiring bravery, service, and dedication serve as an example to all. You deserve every honor for your hard work and sacrifice in serving our country. As Deuteronomy 31, verse 6 says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you." Thank you for everything you do to protect the citizens of this great country, and God bless you.
Good morning, Victory Bible Fellowship Church.
We are so glad that you decided to spend your Sunday morning with us, whether it be in person or online.
Here are some of Victory's announcements.
Youth group is every Friday from 7:30 to 9 p.m. If you are between the ages of 13 and 18, we highly encourage you to join.
We break down the word, do icebreakers, and discuss topics surrounding our youth. It's always a safe space. We hope to see you there.
Believers meeting is every Tuesday from 7:30 to 9 p.m. The current discussions are about character studies from the Bible, so ensure that you make every effort to join and learn more about the Word.
Prayer meetings are on Mondays to Fridays at 5 to 6 a.m. on the prayer line to discuss the importance of prayer and to receive constant encouragement and motivation through God's Word.
Sunday service is every Sunday morning at 11 a.m., where we come together as a church to praise, worship, and learn more about the Word of God. But you already know that, because you're already here.
Those were our announcements.
Have a blessed week and enjoy today's service.
I guess everybody stand at attention. Let's stand before the Lord. Father, we magnify you. We honor you. And we recognize your work here with us today. And today, continue to just dominate the meeting with your presence. Holy Spirit, we are yielded to you. Thank you for just showing yourself strong and mighty on our behalf. So right now, we just release presence of God to continue to do its work among us here, those who are watching and listening, and may the effectiveness of God be seen and Jesus be glorified. We praise you and thank you for all that will be accomplished. Thank you, Lord God, that you are ministering through us. Lord God, not a man, not anybody that we lift up, but we lift up Jesus in this place to be glorified. We thank you in Jesus' name. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Just want to highlight the very important things. We do this every week, so don't tune me out, because we're going to continue to say it over and over, because this is what we do. We have prayer meetings, pre-service prayer on Sundays before service starts. It's open for everyone. Amen? Not just leaders, but for everyone. Mondays to Fridays, 5 to 6, and on Wednesdays at noon to 1, we pray over our children and grandchildren. So everyone should be on and available for that. Amen? And this is ratified by the fact that we had our staff meeting yesterday with leaders, and the bottom line is this. We know that all that we have accomplished this week, this year, is because we've been praying. Amen? Realize that everything starts in our prayer before God and trusting God to, you know, do all the things that he wants to do for us. Amen? So, we're going to do a few things a little different today that you're not accustomed to or used to, but still the Lord in his movement, in his operation, how he works, and what he's going to do. So, Nick is going to play a clip.
I just wanted to share. Have you ever thought about this? In 100 years, so like 21, 23, we will all be buried with our families and friends. Strangers will live in our homes that we worked so hard to build, and someone else will own everything we have today. most of our possessions will be given away or thrown out and destroyed, including the car that we spent a fortune on and will probably be scrapped. Our descendants will hardly know who we are, nor will they remember us. I mean, how many of us know who our grandfather's father was? After we die, we will be remembered for a few more years, and then we're just a portrait on someone's wall. And a few decades later, our history, photos, and deeds disappear into history's oblivion. We won't even be memories. If we pause one day to analyze these questions, perhaps we would understand how pointless it is for us to worry about 95% of the things that consume our minds daily. If we could only think about this, surely our approaches, our thoughts would change and we would do things differently. Perhaps we would feel more free to enjoy ourselves and our lives that we're living. Take these thoughts into the rest of your day, this week, this year, and remember the saying, if it's not going to matter in 5 years, don't spend more than 5 minutes being upset by it. This is really interesting. Our minds daily. If we could only think about this, surely our approaches, our thoughts would change and we would do things differently. Perhaps we would feel more free to enjoy ourselves and our lives.
Didn't hear it quite clearly, but in essence, he was saying that in 100 years from now, all right, 21, 23, all right, saying that, listen, people don't even remember who you are. It's a stranger to be living into the house that you build or live in. Your car's probably in a scrap heap somewhere. All of the material things either thrown away or the thing that was so precious to you here wouldn't matter. Gone. All right? And, you know, they wouldn't even be like, maybe, I mean, a couple, you might have a picture of you somewhere. We don't know what technology will do in terms of preserving things. But, because somebody sent me that clip a couple weeks ago. When I was preparing this, that came back to my memory, and I wanted to use it as a jump-off point, talk about a few things. We are going to be starting a new series. It's going to be for a while about generations and how God moves in generations. All right? So I'm just going to probably do the introduction today as we go about it and see you know how we end up here. But just to continue what it was saying, 100 years, you know, I'm sure you have people here who don't even know their grandparents, let alone their great grandparents. I've been fortunate enough to know my maternal grandmother. I know her very well. I mean, it's probably about 8 or 9 when she passed or something like that. But so I was familiar with her. But some people don't even have that. And think about it. Let's say, for example, you think Adira's great-grandchild will know who I am? So you think about those things and think about what we are building and what we are preparing and, you know. But is it really so? We hear that said that way, and isn't it about the impact you make and what happens in life? For example, everybody know who Abraham Lincoln is and George Washington. It's more than 100 years, right? But history tells a story and is brought down perpetually so that you have an awareness of the impact on who these people represent in the foundation, right? So, to a certain extent, it's about what impact you make in life and as you go about it, how it is received, how the story is told, and all the different things. All right? Like one guy said, you know, then we asked this young fellow what he wants to be. He said he wants to be on TV. He was on TV, all right. He robbed a bank, and it was on the 6 o'clock news. So, as it relates to the mark that we're making on history and the impact that should be lasting, there are things that happen from generation to generation to generation. And the Lord works through generations. I'm going to, you know, it's an introductory thing, so I'm going to look at a few things in terms of, the scriptures related to that, how the Lord laid out a few things, and some, you know, characters we look at as it relates to that. And then we'll get to see that regardless of what is happening, regardless of what your father, your grandfather, your great-grandfather did, everybody has to do something in their generation. And the ultimate thing is that when we all look at it, it's that, what are you doing in your generation? Because it can be that all that's there is just your name, the time you were born and the time you die. Or it can be something that is perpetually causing things to happen throughout generation after generation after generation. Turn with me. I know everybody keeps saying, where's the word? Let's get into the word. Okay, I'm glad you asked. We're going into it. Genesis 49. Genesis 49, this is a story about Joseph. And so the background here is that, you know, we know the story of Joseph. He was sold into slavery and he became a top number two guy and was like a big thing in Egypt, took control of the whole place, did a lot of things. And so his father, who's Jacob, is getting ready to die and he, you know, gather all his sons and he's going to talk to them. So Genesis 49, and we'll start from verse 22. And he's going through all the different sons. He went through Reuben first, and you know, and then he got to Joseph here. So at 22, he said, Joseph is the foal of a wild donkey. The foal of a wild donkey at a spring. One of the wild donkeys on the ridge. Archers attack him savagely. They shot at him and harassed him. But his bow remained taut, and his arms were strengthened by the hands of the mighty one of Jacob. Everybody know that song? By the shepherd, the rock of Israel. May the God of your father help you. May the Almighty bless you with the blessings of the heavens above and blessings of the watery depths below and blessings of the breasts of the womb. May my fatherly blessings on you surpass the blessings of my ancestors. That's important. Reach into the heights of the eternal hills. May these blessings rest on the head of Joseph, who is a prince among his brothers. So this was Jacob now, you know, at the end of his life. You know, this is a good way to go out. You know, but I think he was lived like about 130, gathered all his sons, blessed them, and then checked out and said, peace, I see you. It's a good way. So that's what he did when he gathered them. And he spoke specifically to Joseph about his life. And he did the same thing for all of them, but we're looking at Joseph. So verse 20, it says, these are the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is what their father said as he told his sons goodbye. He blessed each one with an appropriate message. Now, if you read Reuben, there's no blessing. It don't sound like it was a blessing at all. But that's what the scripture said. It's a blessing. Verse 29, then Jacob instructed them, soon I will die and join my ancestors. Bury me with my father and grandfather in the cave in the field of Ephron the Hittite. This is the cave in the field of Machpelah near Mamre in Canaan that Abram bought from Ephron the Hittite as a permanent burial site. So Abram, remember the story, Abram bought this place. So all the patriarchs, you know, they were buried there. While I was doing this, I also saw something very significant. There, Abraham and his wife Sarah are buried. There, Isaac and his wife Rebecca are buried. And you know who else is buried there? Leah, not Rachel. It is the plot of land and the cave that my grandfather, Abram, bought from the Hittites. When Jacob had finished this charge to his sons, he drew his feet up in the bed, breathed his last, and joined his ancestors in death. So I would ask myself, you have to do the research, and I guess some of the Tuesday meetings might bring this up, but did Abraham and Jacob had a relationship? Okay, you have Abraham, then Isaac, then Jacob. Did any of the 12 had a relationship with Isaac? So we don't know explicitly. I need to do some research if there was any relationship. But what was passed on? Was anything like the time when God first gave the call to Abraham to leave his father's house? Did he have a chance to speak to his grandchildren and tell them all that was happening and experience and how that went about? We don't know. But let's talk about Joseph. As a result of him being there, what happened? He did great things in Egypt. He was second to Pharaoh. He saved the world, basically. He preserved life. He made Egypt very rich. And he caused Israel to flourish there. All right? So Israel came. I think 70 of them came. They lived there. And that's how the nation of Israel was birthed, basically, and they started. Genesis chapter 50. God, this is the main point of this introductory piece that I'm going to do that I want us to look into. We're not spending long with this. Genesis 50 from verse 22. So Joseph and his brothers and their families continued to live in Egypt. Joseph lived to the age of 110. He lived to see three generations of descendants of the son of Ephraim. And he lived to see the birth of the children of Manasseh, son Machir, whom he claimed as his own. So you see how much he spent time with and who was with him from different generations. That speaks about something, all right? We're talking about a certain span of influence here. Work with me. Then he says, soon I will die, Joseph told his brothers, but God will surely come to help you and to lead you out of the land of Egypt. Now listen, he received a blessing. He went before his brother, and he wasn't the oldest one. All right? But it says, soon I will die, told his brother, God will surely come and help you and lead you out of this land of Egypt. He will bring you back to the land he solemnly promised to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph made his sons, the sons of Israel, swear an oath that he said, when God comes to help you and to lead you back, you must take my bones with you. So Joseph died at the age of 110. The Egyptians embalmed him, and his body was placed in a coffin in Egypt. That was temporary because his ultimate thing was to go into the land. Even if his bones have to go there, he is going to fulfill the promise of God, right? So let's move forward to Exodus chapter 1. This is where the rubber hits the road. Exodus chapter 1, NLT. From verse 1. These are the names of the sons of Israel, that is Jacob, who moved to Egypt with their father, each with his family, Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, Benjamin, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. In all, Jacob had 70 descendants in Egypt, including Joseph, who was already there. In time, verse 6 is the main verse now. In time, Joseph and all his brothers died, ending that entire what? Generation. All right? But their descendants, the Israelites, had many children and grandchildren. In fact, they multiplied so great that they became extremely powerful and filled the land. Eventually, a new king came to power in Egypt, and he knew nothing about Joseph or what he had done. I mean, Joseph did extraordinary things. All right? Extraordinary things, and I'm not even sure if this was a span of 100 years. I'll probably have to do a research of that, but they knew nothing. So it seemed like people's memory only go within whatever century they're in. I mean, think of all the great people that you want to think of that you know famous. I'm quite sure, I was thinking, I was like, all right, let me think of somebody like Henry Ford. No, he died in 1947. So less than 100 years. All, you know, these. So let me ask you this. It's not a trick question, but it's just a question. All right. Where is this guy? Who knows who is Warren G. Harding? I like the way you said that, Miss Pat. Who? Warren G. Harding. Don't Google it. Warren G. Harding. Who knows? Since you're a history person, who knows that, who that is? Huh? Good. Marie, you know. He's the 29th president of the United States. We know George Washington. We know Abe Lincoln. We know, you know, all our others. But unless you're going to look at his legislative achievements or anything like that, he's the 29th president. That's just it. All right? But he died in August 1923. That's 100 years ago, right? So most of our references seem to only span within 100 years, so to speak, that we can relate to. And so things happen after that. And so the people who have made major contributions that are perpetually from century to century, it doesn't happen like that. It's that what their impact was is being carried forward and carried forward and carried forward and carried forward. Whether good or bad. Because I'm sure you all know who's Christopher Columbus. When he discovered Jamaica. So, quote unquote, discovered Jamaica in 1494. That's more than 100 years, right? So, whatever the experience is, but that somebody or some system or some way perpetuates or push the thing down from generation to generation that they consider to be important. So, we look at our parents and our grandparents, and if we know our great-grandparents, and we look at our children and our great-grandchildren, our grandchildren. What is it in terms of the mark of a generation is expressed that really, really impacts the kingdom of God? So it might be a little nuanced, but it's raising our thinking on a whole nother level. Because I would dare say that God would have it that if we really want to make an impact, it can happen. If the thing, for example, there's some major inventions that take place, I guess, in the 18th and 19th century that we're probably taking them for granted now. Probably even, unless they're before us continuously, they become a part of our lives, we don't even know, unless you have the history about it, or, you know, something that we're using or some name. There are patents out there that are named after people. Unless you study them, you're not going to really know. But I'm saying, the reality of the gospel of Jesus dying on the cross. Nobody here witnessed that, right? But it has been passed on from generation to generation, centuries to centuries, because of the impact and the life-changing thing that it is. So, as I said, this is just the introduction. The wet or apple. We are going to go at least about 6 weeks into talking about generation. And at the end of this, we have to make accountability to ourselves. God, how am I serving in my generation? That's a question to ask. Not necessarily to have a banner or a building made after your name or some kind of endowment, but how does it impact the kingdom? Because as I said, the clip that we saw before, it shows that, you know, hey, might have a nice car now, but 100 years from now, nobody knew that he had that car. But we spent a lot of time and effort changing the oil and taking care of it and doing what we have to do. Right? servicing it. So I want to really then elevate our thinking to things that are eternal and are timeless. Things of the spirit have no box. You know that? For example, let's turn to Psalm 103. Actually, go to Deuteronomy 7 first. Deuteronomy 7. And incidentally, this is after Joseph's time and when Moses is operating. It's very interesting. Deuteronomy 7, 7 says, "The Lord did not set his heart on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other nations. For you were the smallest of all nations. Rather, it was simply that the Lord loves you." What are we talking about today? How the Lord loves you? How does that impact you? When the Lord loves you, what does it force you to do? What does it enable you to do? What does it motivate you to do about knowing that love? And he was keeping the oath he had sworn to your ancestors. Do you think it is different that the Lord would speak to King David and say, "Listen, I have a covenant with you. You're going to always have somebody as a leader in your family. And it's going to happen perpetually." Do you know of any such covenant made to any family member near any other family member? Have you made any covenant with God that you think will perpetuate down in your lineage? So he says, because the Lord loves you, and he was keeping the oath that he had sworn to his ancestors. That is why the Lord rescued you with such a strong hand from your slavery and from the oppressive hand of Pharaoh. That is why, because he loves you. Why were you born in the century and time and place you were born? Because the Lord loves you and he wants to do something. He wants to continue with the covenant that he had. Remember, Jesus was talking to the disciples and said, "Listen, Lord, I pray not only for them, but in John 17, but also those who would believe in the word that they are saying." Remember that? That also talks about us and the word that we are carrying. And he has prayed for us. And the same words that we are speaking to people will hear. Yes, Psalm 103. So basically, the Lord said he loves us and that he's faithful. I didn't finish the point in Deuteronomy 7. So sorry, guys, let's follow me on this. So he said the Lord loves you. That's why the Lord rescued you with such a strong hand from your slavery, from the oppressive hand of Pharaoh of Egypt. And then verse 9 says, "Understand therefore that the Lord your God is indeed God. He is the faithful," not a faithful God, "he is the faithful God who keeps his covenant." How many generations? Now, I am doing a study on 1,000. Because there are some references in the Bible where numbers are concerned, where they mean something significant. For example, number 7 is completion, right? We know that number 8 means new beginning. Now, there are sometimes a number is given, but it's not literally the actual number, but it speaks of infinity. For example, the 70 times 7 is supposed to forgive. Nobody's going to calculate and check off how much time they're going to forgive your brother. It's just to exhaust the fact that you can't even keep up. Okay? So, I don't think there's a cutoff limit for my 1,000 generation. It's about the infinite love that God has for us that perpetuates from generation to generation. But just in case you think that there's a limit on the number, turn to Psalm 103. Because God's love is synonymous with his mercy. You can use them interchangeably. His mercy is his love. Amen. Psalm 103 says, I believe this is either from verse 17, I believe. But the mercy of the Lord. So if you put a thousand generation, it'd have a cutoff point. But it's from everlasting to ever. How long is everlasting to everlasting, Bev? It doesn't stop. Everlasting. Okay. On those who fear him and his righteousness to your children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those who remember, remember his commandments to do them. And I believe, just in case you think everlasting to everlasting is not something you can work with, it's too out there, it's too infinite, it's too out there. You know, like you have a, it's like, you know, you're supposed to be on medication and they give you 40,000 pills. And just keep taking, you know. And he says, too much, I can't work with that. Okay, Lamentations. I don't even remember what chapter. I think it's number chapter 3, but you know the scriptures. Through the Lord's mercies, verse, we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new what? Every morning. So if you forget about yesterday, there's a new one tomorrow. Great is your faithfulness. Amen? They are new every morning. Every morning. Do you know how merciful God is? Have you ever thought of how many things God has taken you out of and preserved so that you can fulfill your purpose in your generation? Things you're supposed to be taken out of. Just in case you don't know, I want to bring something vivid to your mind. Somebody sent me a clip and I want to share it with you. Nick, you ready for the next clip? Please, and give them lights on me again when you get a chance. Just take a good look at this. How much time you have, this has happened to you, or you have seen this, or what could be.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Thy hand hath provided.
quite sure we have our own experiences. About the time you intend to change lanes in your car, and you thought about it, and there goes another car. Why are we preserved? Why are we existing now? It is the love and mercy of God why we're not consumed, right? But it's not just preservation. He has purpose for us. We have to do something in our generation. And we have to understand how he thinks, why generations he perpetuates certain things, and why he preserves us to have things move along, and why history has to sound and to push down the centuries things that he wants to be accomplished. Amen. I want to do some. Give me 10 more minutes. Let's. I heard this in the meeting yesterday when we had the staff, and I was toying with it a little bit today when my preparation and in breaking the bread. But just, we're not bound by time, so just observe the protocol now, and I'm going to ask everybody to let's do a break.
Our God,
our holy, infinite God,
beheld your pain,
perceived your heart,
and determined that your soul was worth dying for.
From the manger to the cross to the empty tomb,
it is all a story of profound love, of a Savior who rescued his children from darkness,
of a blameless king who declared that no sacrifice was too great for the sake of his beloved creation.
Why did Jesus come to earth?
He came for you.
Thank you for joining our service today. We believe that you have been extremely blessed. Raise your right hand with me. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and grant you his peace. Go in the grace of the Lord. Amen.
Surrounded by